Hey, good evening, everybody. Welcome to our home tonight. Thank you so much for giving us some of your time on this beautiful Sunday evening to worship. My family and I, it's an honor that we get a chance to come and bring the word to you. If this is your first time maybe coming across our live feed here on Facebook, my name is Eric Evans. I'm a minister of the gospel of the word and honored to be so. I've been preaching for about 20 years. And I love sharing the word, love worshiping God with my brothers and sisters in Christ like you. And again, thank you so much for being with us tonight. If you would, just drop us a message there in the comment to let us know that you're here. If this is your first time watching us, let us know where you're from. We'd love to know where you're from. And of course, very importantly, if you have a prayer request, please, please put those in the comments. And we will pray over those in just a little bit. Also, my family and I will come back later after this service, and we will pray for you all together. And thank you so much. I do want to, before I get into back into the series that we've been in, I want to, some of you who watched last Sunday evening may have noticed I was wearing a t-shirt like this. It says, I see God every day. For those of you who follow my posts on Facebook, I do a morning devotional every day, and it's a phrase that I just say over and over again, I see God every day, or seeing God every day, and I feel like the Lord has led us to a ministry where we just try to help people to see God truly every day and in everyday life situations. So you'll notice that in the types of things that I post about on Facebook, the things we talk about, even the things that come out in my sermons, because I believe it's extremely important for us to have a relationship with God, a regular daily relationship with God. And I truly believe that if you're looking for Him, you can see Him everywhere, every day. And that's why we say, I see God every day. So we had a few of these shirts made up really for us to wear, and I had a couple of people to ask me about them. Really hadn't intended on getting into selling merchandise or anything like that, but if you would like a shirt like that and you'd be interested in purchasing one, let me know. Put a comment down below, and if we have enough interest, we'll order some more, and we might be able to use that as an opportunity to raise some money to do some ministry things together. So again, if you're interested in getting one of those t-shirts, just drop us a message down below, and we will think about ordering some more. So I have been in a series for the last several weeks titled Studying the Scriptures Through Song. And so what we've been doing is we've been looking at different songs, some hymns that have been around for over 100 years, some contemporary songs, and we're looking at them and, you know, just allowing them to bless us as they do all by themselves, but also using them as an opportunity to, as a springboard into the Word of God. And so we are continuing in that series today. And so as you continue to put your prayer requests there in the comments, I want to share with you the song that we are using today. And I know as soon as I start playing it, you're going to recognize it. It's probably one of the more popular songs in the last couple of decades. Listen to it. It's by Bishop Marvin Sapp. Powerful song. It ministers to me every time that I hear it. I'm sure if you've ever heard it, it ministers to you as well. You know, one of the things that we have noticed in some of the songs we brought to you is that oftentimes they have a story behind them. And a lot of times these songs are born out of some painful situation. And it came out of a tough time or something that the writer was going through. And certainly this is the same with this song. Bishop Marvin Sapp, who's a gospel singer, has been around for probably 20 years or so, is a minister of the word. In 2006, his father passed away. And brokenhearted and dealing with the pain and a heartache of his father passing, It was about 3 days after his father's funeral. He was back in the pulpit in his home church. And at the end of the service, he got up, as the story goes. He had not thought about this song, but he just started allowing the Spirit of God to flow through him. And he grabbed the microphone and just started singing the words. The words just started pouring out of his spirit. Never would have made it. And he certainly, it was healing for him. And of course, it became an anthem for so many Christians, and certainly a song that has blessed me. And you know, he lost his wife to cancer a few years later in 2010. And I'm sure certainly those same words came pouring out of his spirit again. And he sang to the Lord, "Never would have made it without you." How many of you can testify that there have been times that you've had some challenge, some obstacle in your way, some problem, maybe the loss of a loved one in your life, and you just felt like you just knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that you never would have made it without God in your life? Isn't that song a blessing, so powerful? And we thank the Lord for being with us in the difficult times that we face. And we're going to use that song tonight as a way to minister through the Word of God based on the words of that song. But before we do, I'd like to pray with you. Let's consider us going to the altar and bringing our prayer requests to the Lord. Let's bow our heads and pray together if we could. Father in heaven, we thank you so much, Lord, for the blessing of our gathering. We don't take it lightly, Lord, of all the things that you've had to order in our lives. That number one, that we would know you. Number two, that we would believe in you. And number three, that we would trust you enough that we would gather our hearts the way that we are and pray to you. Father, what a privilege it is just for us to be able to call your name. We are not worthy, Lord, but we are grateful. So, Father, I lift up tonight all of those that have joined with us in this virtual way. We thank you, Father, for the body of Christ, my brothers and sisters. Some I know, some I have never met. But Father, I lift them up before you tonight. We boldly but respectfully come before your throne of grace. I ask, Lord, that you help us, that you help us through these difficult times that we are facing. There are some, Lord, maybe who've asking prayer tonight that's facing maybe the loss of a loved one. Maybe they're facing an illness for themselves or for someone close to them. Maybe it's somebody, Lord, that's just feeling like they've had all that they could take through this pandemic and all these other things that are going on, Lord. I just pray that you give them the strength just to take one more step, Lord, that they will trust you enough to believe in you, Lord, just to take one more step. Father, we especially lift up those many, many people all along the East Coast, starting in the Caribbean and Florida, Lord, that's facing a tropical storm. Lord, you know that the forecast says that it's expected to come all along the East Coast and even to possibly affect us here where we live in North Carolina. I pray your protection over us, Lord. Please, Lord, if it's your will, steer that storm out into the sea. But if not, I pray, Lord, that you will protect us, you will wrap your loving arms around us, and that you will see us through. So that, Lord, that once we come through it, that we will pray to you and we'll be able to say we never would have made it without you. Father, we love you and we thank you. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for praying with us. I want to ask if you would to go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 45 is where we're going to be tonight. But again, reflecting on that song by Bishop Marvin Sapp, Never Would Have Made It. Certainly, not only is this song important because it was such a popular song when it came out in 2007, I believe it is. It's important not just because it was so popular and it touched so many people, but also it's important because I believe there's a very strong biblical message in the lyrics of that song. And surely the refrain of that song that they repeat over and over, never would have made it. It's not only just a hook, and certainly it does hook you. It draws you in, whether you feel like you can sing or not. That song draws you in, and you feel like you gotta sing it. And we didn't sing it tonight, because I'm gonna tell you, there's nobody who can sing that song like Marvin Sapp. But it draws you in, but that it's not just a hook. That refrain is not just a hook that's catchy. It is also a praise for us to use to lift up to our Heavenly Father. We give God praise for the fact that whatever it is that we've made it through in our lives, and I'm sure some of you have made it through some tough times. I know I have. My family and I have. We certainly wouldn't have enough time tonight to go down the list, but if we've made it through anything, and I know that we have, the only reason that we've made it through is because of God and His grace. And so we lift that song up. Not just as an encouragement to each other, but as a praise to God, to thank Him for helping us to make it through whatever it is we've been through in our lives. But I don't want us just to focus on that refrain, never would have made it. I think there's also an equally important message in the verse. I think it gives a deeper meaning behind it when we look at the verse that says, I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better, so much better, he says. When I look back over all that you brought me through, I can see that you were the one I held on to. He said, I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better. And that's really the part of the song that I want to focus on tonight. It's not just about God getting us through problems. It's not just God helping us to climb the mountain or to cross that river or to make it through that death of a loved one or to make it through that sickness or that family problem or that relational problem, whatever it is. It's not just about making it through. But it's about what God does in us and through us and how He changes us as He takes us through. That's why it's important for us to listen when He says in the song, I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better. So much better is what He says. And that's really what I want to focus on tonight. And we're going to look to the Word of God, to a story in the Old Testament that I think will help us to understand better this biblical principle, I believe, of God taking us through difficult situations and what He does in us, how He changes us through those difficult situations. And so I want us, if we could, to look to Genesis chapter 45, and I'm going to read from the New Living Translation. Certainly, you can read from whatever version you feel comfortable reading from. And I'm going to read verses 1 through 8. Sister Tanya is going to post those verses there in the comments. In Genesis chapter 45, beginning at verse 1, it says, Joseph could stand it no longer. There were many people in the room, and he said to his attendants, Out, all of you. So he was alone with his brothers when he told them who he was. Then he broke down and wept. He wept so loudly the Egyptians could hear him, and word of it quickly carried to Pharaoh's palace. I am Joseph, he said to his brothers. Is my father still alive? But his brothers were speechless. They were stunned to realize that Joseph was standing there in front of them. Please come closer, he said to them. So they came closer, and he said again, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into slavery in Egypt. But don't be upset, and don't be angry with yourselves for selling me to this place. Listen to this. It was God who sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives. This famine that has ravaged the land for 2 years will last 5 more years, and there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. God has sent me ahead of you to keep you and your families alive and to preserve many survivors. So it was God who sent me here, not you. And he is the one who made me an advisor to Pharaoh, the manager of his entire palace and the governor of all Egypt. Tonight in my message, I want to share with you from the title, Will They Recognize You After You Make It Through? Will they recognize you after you make it through? Let's pray together again, if we could. Father, we thank you so much, Lord, for allowing us to come before your holy and precious word. I thank you, Lord, from all of those years that these words were first written down until now, you have exercised your power and your might to preserve them, Lord, that we might have them here to read, to understand, and more importantly, to apply to our lives. Father, we thank you for all that you've done for us, and I just pray that your word becomes real in our life. Lord, we love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to give you some background, if I could, and I'm sure you know the story of Joseph in the Old Testament, but let me refresh your memories if I could. So, you know that Joseph was one of the sons of Jacob, and Jacob later became known as Israel. He was the next to the youngest son. He was favored by his father, and his brothers grew very jealous of him. And that jealousy grew and grew in their hearts to the point that they got together and they decided they were going to kill him, to kill their own brother. Now, you may have heard me say this before, and it's important enough for me to say it again. Jealousy is a strange but powerful emotion. And I would encourage us all, including myself, that the moment we see jealousy start to spring up in our hearts, we'd better deal with it immediately, because it is one of those strange and powerful emotions that if we let it get away from us, it will drive us to do things that we never thought that we would ever do. I'm sure that these men never thought that they would get to a point where they were actually sitting down making plans to kill their own brother. And that's how jealousy can be. So they were making plans to kill him. Oldest brother, Reuben, says, wait, no, let's not do that. We shouldn't kill him. Let's just throw him into a pit and leave him there and see what happens. So they threw him into a pit. You know the story. He was pulled out of the pit by these men who were slave traders. They took him down to Egypt. They sold him as a slave, where he became the slave of a man named Potiphar. And he was as a slave. He worked there in Potiphar's house. Though he was a slave, he seemed to gain some favor with Potiphar. Potiphar took a liking to him, but unfortunately, Potiphar's wife took a liking to him as well. She started coming on to him and tempting him and trying to encourage him to lie with her. And being the godly man that he was, he refused. In fact, one day, as there was no one else in the house, she was trying to tempt him, and she was getting a little too close, and he was running away. He went to run away, and she grabbed his coat and pulled it off of him as he ran out. Of course, she was upset by it and everything, and she lied on him and said that he tried to take advantage of her. Well, because of her lie, Joseph was thrown into jail, and he was there for a few years. Even while he was in jail, he found favor with the jail master. And the jail master sort of put him in charge of the other prisoners there. And it was also at that time that he showed the gift that God had given him to interpret dreams. Long story short, it was that gift that later that he was able to get out of prison, and Pharaoh wanted him to come to live in his palace. He found favor again with Pharaoh. And Pharaoh eventually put him as like governor of all of his land. He became second in charge under Pharaoh himself. So certainly we can see that though he was in a bad situation where he went from a pit to being a slave, then into prison, and then eventually he became servant of Pharaoh and later second in command, he went through this whole process that God was taking him through. And then as the story goes, later there was a famine back in his homeland where his brothers and his father were living. And so in order to survive, they decided to go down to Egypt because they had heard that Egypt was faring well during this famine. They had no idea that their brother Joseph was there, that he was in the position that he was in, and that really he was responsible for Egypt doing as well as they were during that famine. But they go down there and they're looking for a way to survive. They're looking for food, a way to find shelter during this famine. And eventually comes to this point here in Genesis chapter 45 where they are being reunited with their brother. Now, when they first saw Joseph, they didn't know it was him. Last they knew, he was their young brother, Dusty. They'd thrown him into the pit and didn't know what happened to him. They didn't know whether he was alive or dead. They certainly didn't expect that the man that they were looking at, who was, you know, exercising his authority and running things in Egypt, they'd never expected that to be their brother. Not only did they not recognize him because of the way he was dressed and the authority that he had, they didn't recognize him because I'm sure they thought if they ever met him again, that they would run into a very angry and bitter person who was bent on revenge. And that's not who they saw there in Egypt. It's because the process, that process from the pit to prison all the way to the palace, it is that process that God was using to change Joseph. He was making him, as the song says, stronger, wiser, and better. Have you made it through some difficult times in your life? And if so, how did you come out on the other side? Did you come out stronger and wiser and better? Or did you come out on the other side weaker and meaner and further from God than when you started? You know, even as we face this pandemic that who knows when it's going to be over? Who knows when we can go back to not having to wear a mask or not worry about whether we are 6 feet apart from one another? Who knows when we'll be able to go back and do things that we're not able to do right now, like go see a movie? We were just talking about that earlier. We miss being able to go to a movie theater. You know, who knows how long this is going to be? You know, so we're going through this, and then there is social unrest. We see that there is still racism that is alive and well here in our nation and such, in rearing its head in such ugly ways. And now, on top of all of that, we've got a hurricane, well, really a tropical storm now that's heading in our direction. And my question is, when you make it through all of this, and I believe by the grace of God, we're going to make it through all of this. But the real question is, how will you make it through? And what will you be like when you make it through this? You know, Pastor John Piper says in a book that he wrote not too long ago about the coronavirus, You know, he said that if we're not allowing God to change us in the midst of this, we're wasting this opportunity. This is an opportunity to allow God to change us from the inside out. So we need to say, okay, Lord, whatever it is, the purpose for this, I'm going to let this process change me. And the key to that, the key to us coming out the other side of this, the other side of this hurricane, the other side of this pandemic, the other side of this racial unrest, the other side of your personal situation in your family, the other side of the death of your loved one, the key to us understanding how we can come out on the other side stronger and wiser and better is that we've got to understand this. God's process has a purpose to improve our position. I'll say that again. God's process has a purpose to improve our position. Before I touch base on those three key points in that sentence, I want, if you would, to go on further in your Bible to Genesis chapter 50. And let's look at verse 14. Let's see, you know, there were some other dealings between Joseph and his brothers, but I want us to look even further at this point in Genesis chapter 50 to see, again, how it is that Joseph came out on the other side stronger, wiser, and better, and how he ultimately was able to see that God's process has a purpose to improve our position. In verse 14, it says of Genesis chapter 50, says, after burying Jacob, his father had died, their father had died, Jacob, Joseph returned to Egypt with his brothers and all who had accompanied him to his father's burial. But now that their father was dead, Joseph's brothers became fearful. Quote, now Joseph will show his anger and pay us back for all the wrong we did to him, they said. So they sent this message to Joseph, quote, before your father died, he instructed us to say to you, please forgive your brothers for the great wrong they did to you, for their sin in treating you so cruelly. So we, the servants of the God of your father, beg you to forgive our sin. You know, he had so far greeted them with kindness and love, but now their father had died and his brothers were worried that maybe he was only showing them that kindness and that grace because their father was still living and he was doing it so he wouldn't upset their father. And now they are fearful that now that their father is deceased, that now Joseph is going to show how he really feels. And, you know, honestly, any of us, had we been through that, we probably would not have been showing love and grace and mercy and compassion as he had. I'm sure many of us, would have been holding on to that grudge. And you know, that grudge, if you hold on to it, it will fester and it will grow. And that grudge would have kept growing. And no matter how long of a period of time we've been holding on to it, we have it right there ready. And we would have probably wanted revenge against our brethren had they done such a thing to us. Because you got to remember, this wasn't just some trick or prank that they played on him. They thought about killing him. Threw him in a pit. He became a slave, taken from his home, made a slave, thrown into jail, falsely accused, all of these things. And so they were afraid as to how Joseph was going to respond. But it says there, second part of verse 17, when Joseph received the message, he broke down and wept. Then his brothers came and threw themselves down before Joseph. Look, we are your slaves, they said. But Joseph replied, don't be afraid of me. Am I God that I can punish you? Joseph is reminding us of a very important biblical truth that vengeance belongs to the Lord, not to us. We are to show compassion and grace and mercy even to our enemies, even those who have done us wrong, even those who have spitefully used us. And we are to allow God to take care of vengeance if there's vengeance to be had. And he says again, don't be afraid of me. Am I God that I can punish you? You intended to harm me. Listen to this. You intended to harm me, but God intended it all for good. He brought me to this position so I could save the lives of many people. No, don't be afraid. I will continue to take care of you and your children. So he assured them by speaking kindly to them. In the King James Version, it says there in verse 20, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. And how in the world was it that Joseph was able to go through all of that? How was it? He didn't just make it through. He didn't just come out on the other side and said, never would have made it without you, Lord, and then turn around and try to get vengeance on his brothers. He was a different person. He was stronger. He was wiser. He was better, so much better. And I believe it's because he understood in his heart that God's process has a purpose to improve our position. Let's take those one by one. The process. You got to understand that no matter what you are going through, no matter how bad it can be sometimes, even if you're going through something bad because somebody meant it for evil, even if it's Satan himself that's bringing pain and heartache in your life as he can, even if it's that, is all a part of God's process. And it's the process that makes us stronger and wiser and better. You know, we want to go from kindergarten to 12th grade and graduate all in the same day in our spiritual lives, right? We want God to just send us the footnotes, just to, you know, give us the answers to the question, let us go ahead and take it and graduate all at the same time so we can get from point A to point B all in the same day. But it does not work like that. God often deals with us through a process. If you're a born-again believer, from the day that Christ quickened your heart, as the Bible says, you already had your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Had you drawn your last breath that very same day, you would have immediately gone to heaven. But if there is time, if there are days, if there are weeks, if there are months, if there are years between the day that Christ saved you and the day that you draw your last breath, then in that window of time, God is going to take you through a process, and it is a process. I mean, even just for me to be along far enough in my walk with the Lord that I feel comfortable and confident enough to sit here before you the way that I am and even attempt to share with you from the Word of God is only because God has taken me through a process. I did not leave the pulpit on the Sunday that I got saved in 1997 and walk out that door fully understanding the Word of God, fully understanding the key doctrines of God's Word, fully mature enough in my faith where I was able to teach the Word and lead people to Christ and all of those things. There's no way. But since that day to this very day, God has been taking me through a process. And every hill that I've had to climb, every river that I have had to cross, every tear that has rolled down my cheek has been a part of that process. And I know that every mountain, every river, and with every tear, I prayed, at least hoped in my heart, that God would take it away, that he would just remove that mountain, that he would just you know, miraculously take me to the other side of that river, that he would wipe away that tear, let it be the last one, and I never cried another one. I hoped for that, and sometimes I prayed for that, but God didn't take away all the mountains. He didn't take away all the rivers, and he certainly has not taken away all of the tears. It's because it's all part of a process. Satan may have meant it to break my spirit, to get me to turn away from God, maybe even to curse God's name. But what Satan meant for evil, God has meant for good, and it's part of a process. And so now, as we not just look back over the mountains and rivers behind us, but we also look ahead to the mountains and rivers ahead of us, and we get anxious, we become afraid, we get nervous, sometimes we want to throw in the towels. Remind yourself, even all of that is a part of God's process for you. And what they meant it for evil, God means it for good. And it leads to the second point, the purpose. God's process has a purpose. God has an end in mind. God has a place in mind for you already. God already has in mind what he wants you to do and what you will need so that you will be able to do it. God already knows what you will face in your life tomorrow and next year and the year after that. He knows what you will need to be able to get through what you're going to go through. And so what you are facing right now and what you've already been through is a part of God's purpose. And perhaps he has put you through what you've gone through so that your purpose would be you could lead others who know the pain that you know to Christ. Maybe you've been through the loss of a husband or a wife so that God can get you to a place that one day you will be able to share the gospel with somebody who's been in a similar situation. Maybe the Lord has delivered you from addictions, maybe to alcohol or drugs or whatever it might be, pornography or whatever. Maybe God has allowed you to go through that because his purpose is to deliver you so then your testimony can draw someone else to him. Maybe that's the purpose. You know, I'll tell you a real quick story. Some of you have heard this story before. I used to teach high school, and that's what I went to college for and everything is what I intended my career to be in. And after I'd been out teaching for a couple of years, I went back to graduate school. My goal was to become a principal one day. My oldest brother, Ralph, if he happens to watch this, he's been my idol in my professional career, and I thank God for him. He went that same path. He's retired now. And so my plan was that I was going to go to college, get my master's degree, and one day become a principal and maybe even work at, you know, maybe become a superintendent or something like that. And but as I was in graduate school, you know, graduate school is expensive. I was working full time. Tanya and I had just started a family. We had Ariel was a baby, and, you know, all of that. Was going to school at night, and it got really tough. And there was a program out there called the Principals Fellows Program, where if you applied and got accepted, that you could go to graduate school full time, and it would pay you a stipend so that you didn't have to work. And I said, "Oh, that's perfect for me." And I was like, "Yes, thank you, Lord. That program was just meant for me. I know you've opened this door for me." I applied for it. I was so excited. I just knew. I felt like I fit every category that they were looking for. They wanted more men in the school system, more minorities in the school system, all this stuff. I said, "Oh, that's just for me." And so I applied for it, and I waited. And a couple of weeks later, I got a letter in the mail. And it was just one letter. You could tell it was just an envelope with one piece of paper in it. I didn't think that was a good sign. Usually when you get accepted to something, they send you a packet of information, right? When they reject you, they send you just a letter. It was just a letter. And the letter said that, you know, it was very competitive, had a lot of people apply, whatever, whatever. I didn't get in. I was crushed. I felt very disappointed in God. And at that time, I was not as spiritual mature as I am now. Maybe I'm not as spiritual mature as I need to be now, but I certainly was not then. I had no idea what God's purpose was in me not getting in that program. I didn't know. I just felt like there was no way I'd be able to, you know, continue graduate school and all of that. Long story short, I realized later that God had a different plan for me. That God had something already laid out. I didn't know then, but He knew before I was even born. He had a whole nother profession prepared for me. He had another leadership role that He was planning for me to go into that I didn't even know about at the time. I wasn't interested in at the time. And God started, He closed that door only so that He could open other doors. But more importantly than the doors He opened for me in my professional career and what I do now full time, more importantly, He also had a ministry plan for not just me, but for my family. He knew that He would call me to be a deacon one day. And I thank God for Trinity Baptist Church and Pastor Al Cooper that they saw God's call in my life and they ordained me to be a deacon, and later they ordained me to be a minister of the gospel. I thank God for the opportunities that they gave us there at the church. I love them so much. Pastor Al, I love you so much for all the support you've shown to me and my family. And God had all of these things planned. You see, God, even in that process, God had a purpose. I didn't always know. In fact, I rarely knew what that purpose was, but I had to learn to trust that God did have a purpose. And one day it would become apparent to me what that purpose was, but until then I had to trust God. And I'm encouraging you tonight that whatever you're going through, understand that it is God's process, and His process has a purpose. And that purpose is meant for good, not for evil. It's meant for good, not for evil. And the final thing is this: God's process has a purpose to improve your position. Now, I want to make it clear that sometimes people will look at this story in Scripture and they will see how Joseph went from being that little boy, the young son of Jacob, the one that his brothers couldn't stand, and you know, who went from the pit to the palace. You know, they talk about that only in terms that we're going to get a promotion in the eyes of the world. And certainly it could be that. Certainly God could be elevating us in positions that this world would recognize as a promotion, but sometimes it's not that. So when I say position, I'm not talking about a promotion on your job necessarily. I'm not talking about making more money necessarily. I'm not talking about being more well known to people necessarily. It could be that, but that's not what this is about. When I say God's process has a purpose to improve your position, the position that I'm talking about is your position with God, your proximity to God, your closeness, how close you are to God. You see, the Lord took Joseph through that process, and it was for a purpose, to save his family because of it, but also so that Joseph could grow closer to God, close enough that when he was reunited with his brothers, he didn't, you know, turn a cold shoulder to them. He didn't threaten to get them back for what they had done. He showed the grace of God. And it takes somebody that has gotten closer and closer to the Lord to be able to respond the way Joseph responded. So when I say that God's process has a purpose to improve your position, I mean your position with God, how close you are to God. You know, oftentimes I have, many of you know, I pastored a church for 10 years, and in that 10 years, I had the honor and opportunity to preach many funerals. I preached funerals from a baby that was 5 days old to, you know, people in their 90s. And oftentimes, as I'm speaking words to the family, the Lord brings it to my heart to say, you know, allow this pain that you're going through to bring you closer to each other and closer to God. And certainly, the pain that we all can go through, whether it's because we've lost someone that we love, or just the hurt and pain we feel from the world that we're surrounded by right now, my prayer is that this will not push you away from God, but it will draw you closer to God. This pandemic might be over tomorrow. God could do that if he wanted. Or it might be another year, another 2 years before they get a vaccine and enough people take the vaccine for people to start developing immunity and all. We could be under this for a long time. But whenever it is that we come out on the other side of this, my prayer is that you would be closer to God, not further away from him, but closer to him. My prayer is that God's process will bring a purpose in your life that will improve your position, that you will be closer to God. My prayer is that if you're nervous and anxious and afraid even of this tropical storm that's coming our way, we live in a county that has been flooded many times, and just a regular heavy rain in the summertime makes people nervous. My prayer is that once we get on the other side of it, that we're not just singing, never would have made it, never would have made it without you, but that we'll realize that our position has improved with God, that we are closer to him. I pray that whatever it is that you might be facing, don't just get through it. God can get you through it, but allow him to change you in the process. Allow him to change you from the inside out, so that you can be able to say that people won't recognize you once you've made it through, that you are so different. You're so much more Christ-like. You're so different from the person that you used to be that people won't even recognize you, just as they didn't recognize Joseph. My brothers and sisters, let's not waste the pain of the place we are in this world right now. If we gotta go through it, let's at least come out on the other side more like Christ and closer to our Heavenly Father. Let's close in prayer if we could. Father, I thank you, Lord, that we can find hope and strength and courage, even in all that we face in this world now, just by knowing that your process has a purpose to improve our position. Father, I pray that very soon that what we're going through right now, we'll be able to shout to the rooftops that we never would have made it without you. And that's surely true of what we go through. But Father, I pray that we come out on the other side stronger and wiser and better. And more importantly, I pray that we come out closer to you. Father, I thank you for allowing me this opportunity to share your word with your people. I pray, Lord, that I've done your word justice. Pray that you be magnified, Lord, that you be glorified, and Lord, in you that we all would be satisfied. Father, we love you. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for just giving of your time on a Sunday evening to worship the Lord together with us. Again, I would encourage you, if you don't already, to watch for my devotionals that I put on Facebook every morning. That come out, you know, not exact same time every morning, but somewhere between 5:30 and 7 o'clock or so. I would encourage you to read those. Again, you know, my hope in doing those is that, you know, you'd be able to see God every day. I would encourage you also to go to our YouTube channel at Rev Eric Evans, and go there. You can see previous messages that I've done. If you haven't already, go there and subscribe. I'd love to see that. Like if you like it, and that would just encourage us to keep doing what we're doing. If you haven't already, send me an email to Rev Eric Evans at gmail.com. I will add you to our list. And I will send you information, reminders of things that we are doing in the ministry. And again, as I said at the beginning, we ordered just a few of these just for us. We didn't intend to get into merchandise or anything like that. We did have a couple of people that showed some interest. If you'd be interested in purchasing one of those t-shirts, just drop a comment there and let us know. And if we have enough interest, we'll order some more. Maybe we can use it as a fundraiser to do some ministry together. How about that? But again, thank you so much for joining us. God bless you, and I pray that you have a blessed week in the Lord. God bless you.